There was a mother who had a rambunctious little boy, and as he got older, you know, got out of the nursery and was sitting in church, and he had a hard time sitting still. He fidgeted and he would scoot around. We had one like that when we were growing up, and our little girl used to crawl underneath the seats. But anyway, this little boy was having a hard time sitting still in church, and his mom tried a lot of different things, you know, coloring and all this, but he was just this squirmy little boy, just couldn't hold still. But one day in the middle of the service, the pastor had noticed this, and he knew the mom was having trouble, and he just preached on. But one day he looked out there and he noticed the mom lean over and whisper something in the little boy's ear. And he sat up straight and didn't move the rest of the service. And the pastor was so impressed with this. So on the way out, he saw the mom and knew she had been struggling with this squirmy little boy. And she said, "I saw today that you got your son to sit still. What on earth did you say to him?" She said, "Well, you know, I had this moment that I thought what would really do it. I told him that if he didn't sit still, that you would lose your place in the sermon and you would have to start all over again." That'll do it. So, today we come to the end of the book of Acts. As we said last week we've been several months in the book of Acts. So, if you don't sit still and listen, I'll have to start all over. No, not really. But we're wrapping up the book of Acts today. So, open your Bibles to Acts chapter 27. We'll hit chapters 27 and 28 as we wrap up the story of the Acts of the Apostles, is what it's called. And so we've been tracing this story, which started when the Lord Jesus Christ ascended into heaven and told his disciples, "You will be witnesses for me when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. We'll receive power and you'll be witnesses for me in all the world, from Jerusalem to Judea, to Samaria and to the very ends of the earth." And this is what the Holy Spirit is going to do. And then we've been tracing this advancement of the gospel out through all the world as it went to the Jews all over. And then finally this great and marvelous thing that the Jews could not comprehend, but that the gospel even saved the Gentiles of all people. And they had taken a while to accept this thing. But now the gospel is going out to the Gentiles. But we've also traced the opposition. Everywhere Paul went and everywhere the disciples went, there was always opposition to the gospel. There was always opposition to the truth. And yet, in the midst of that, they kept pressing on. They kept pressing on. We see some that were actually martyred for the cause of Christ because they stood firm on the word and stood firm on the gospel. We saw several people that were martyred, particularly Stephen, and also the brother of John, James, was martyred and put to death because of their testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ and because of the gospel. And we've been tracing this story of the book of Acts all the way through. We've seen Paul go on his three missionary journeys. And last week, we got him to Jerusalem, to Caesarea, and this week, he goes to Rome. And that's where we are. Well, the book of Acts, he makes his trip to Rome. So Paul has appealed to Caesar, because he didn't want to go back to Jerusalem and be tried by the Jews because he knew they were plotting to kill him. So he appeals to Caesar. And so now he's going to go to Caesar. In chapter 27, we find that a boat sets out sail for Rome. And Paul and some other prisoners are put on this boat and they take off and they start to go. But it's in kind of in the winter time when storms are really bad in the sea and they're questioning whether or not they should go. Paul warns them that says, if we go, you know, out to sea and try to make it to Rome, everybody's life is going to be put in danger. But they go, you're just that stupid preacher, so they didn't listen to him. They go out to sea, and what happens? Some of you know the story. A violent storm comes up, and it begins to toss this boat around for days, for weeks. They're adrift at sea. They don't even know where they are, and this storm is coming. They begin to throw things overboard. They throw their cargo overboard. They throw the tackle overboard. They throw everything overboard to try to lighten the ship because they're afraid that they're going to sink. And this goes on for days and days and days. But finally, they come near what they think they might be getting near shore. They take some depth sounds. They realize the water is getting more shallow. It's not as deep. And they finally come upon land. They see some land in the distance. And Paul has encouraged them, though, even though they were in danger, he has told them nobody's going to die. As they get near the land and they drop anchor, they decide, well, if the prisoners escape, that's going to be bad for us, so they're going to kill all the prisoners. But Paul says, nope. I promise you, no one will escape. Don't do this. We'll all be there. And so the captain listens to Paul. They don't kill the prisoners, but ultimately they run the boat aground in the sand off the shore, and they have to jump in the water and swim to shore, and they all make it. So they make it to this island. It's an island called Malta. And here's our last little overview of you see where they take off and they sail. When they leave the little port of Fairhavens on the island of Crete, it's when they hit the storm. And they're adrift out in the sea for a long time. They don't even know where they are. So they make these different journeys, and they wind up in this little island of Malta. And when they get on the shore there, they don't even really know where they are at first. They have to figure out that they're on this island. And they wind up staying there pretty much through the winter. But when they first come ashore, something happens. They begin to build a fire. You might remember this story. And this kind of gets us into chapter 28, where they build this fire. Paul's sitting by the fire, and a snake comes out and bites him on the hand. He's a poison. It's a very poisonous snake. And all the people from the natives of the island go, he must have been a murderer, because we know he's going to die. This is the poison of the snake. Nobody survives a bite from this snake. And Paul just goes, throws the snake off in the fire, and he doesn't die. So they think he's this God. But he has this opportunity through these few months to begin to share with the people there on the island. Again, I'm summarizing this for you so we can kind of get into what really happens. Finally, after the winter, they get on another ship. They make it to Rome. Paul finally gets to Rome. Now we're in chapter 28. And Paul is going, he's in Rome now. And he is under what they call maybe house arrest. He's able to live in a house with a Roman guard watching him. So he has a little bit of freedom. He's not like in a prison. But he's still guarded by a Roman soldier. So he has people can come and go. In chapter 28, verse 17, we pick up our story. It says, 3 days later, he called together the leaders of the Jews. When he had assembled, Paul said to them, "My brothers, although I have done nothing against our people or against the customs of our ancestors, I was arrested in Jerusalem and handed over to the Romans. They examined me and wanted to release me because I was not guilty of any crime deserving death. But the Jews objected. I was compelled to appeal to Caesar, not that I had any charge to bring against my own people. I had any charge to bring against my own people. For this reason, I have been asked to see you and to talk to you. It is because of the hope of Israel that I am bound with this chain." They replied, "We have not received any letters from Judea concerning you, and none of the brothers who have come from there has reported anything bad about you." Oh, cool. Anyway, but we want to hear what your views are, and we want to know that the people everywhere are talking about this sect. This group, this way, is called a sect of Israel. So they arranged for Paul to meet with them, and then Paul, it says here, from morning till evening, he explained and declared to them the kingdom of God and tried to convince them about Jesus from the law of Moses and from the prophets. So now again, his motivation or his MO, his modus operandi was to go into a city and talk to the Jews first. That's pretty much what he did. Because the gospel went to the Jews first and then to the Gentiles. It wasn't he was opposed to preaching to the Gentiles, but he always went in, and now he's preaching to these Jews. And they don't really know anything yet. So he begins to take the Bible, basically the Old Testament, and begins to use the Old Testament to point them that Jesus is the Messiah. He's the one that was promised, and he's using the scriptures to try to teach them. Now, as is typical, everywhere Paul went, some believed, and some didn't. Some believe this word. But notice Paul here is preaching two things. The kingdom of God, and he's preaching Jesus. Okay, we're going to come back to those in just a minute. So some believe, some don't, and we're going to kind of wrap up the book right here at the very end, verse 28. Therefore, I want you to know, he's telling the Jews, that God's salvation has been sent to the Gentiles, and they will listen. He quotes a passage from the Old Testament about how the Jews are going to reject. And then he says, well, I want you to know this. The gospel has gone beyond just to the Jews now. It's gone to the Gentiles, and they're going to listen. Some of you are the people he's talked about. The Gentiles have listened. They've heard the gospel. They've received it. Then it says, for 2 whole years, Paul stayed there in his town, in his own rented house, and welcomed all who came to him. Boldly and without hindrance, he preached the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's where the book of Acts ends. So we see Paul, regardless of the fact, regardless of whatever he faced, he always preached the truth of the word. He preached the kingdom of God, and he preached the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is how the kingdom of God is advanced. Some of you, I know that are interested, or maybe have gone on mission trips, or maybe you're interested in missions. And some of you, I know, have faced a little bit of objection from your family. Some people don't understand this call to go. I mean, we're Americans, right? You went to college to get a degree, right? You get a degree, you get out, and you get married, you work hard, you raise a family, you build a home, and you have all this, and you live the American dream. But every now and then, God gets a hold of one of you and says, I'm going to send you out into the world. And God gets a hold of your heart. And you go, yeah. And everybody goes, are you crazy? What are you doing? But something, God gets a hold of you and it says, you need to go. And so you go. And some of your family members go, no, you're wasting your life, young man. Why do you want to waste your life going into missions? And you go, I'm not wasting my life. I'm doing the will of God. And it's hard sometimes for people who just don't understand the gospel and just don't understand this compulsion of the Holy Spirit within us that pushes us beyond the borders. It pushes us out in to go take these risks for the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, not every one of you is going to be a missionary. Some of you are going to stay right here in the good old USA, and some of you will never leave Nebraska. And you go, woohoo! You can't ever imagine living in Mississippi. Good gracious. But that's okay, because God has a place for some of you here, but there'll be some who'll take that step. Some of you know that we have a son who lives in Johannesburg, South Africa. He went there as a missionary with Transworld Radio. And we just had our second grandbaby, which we haven't only seen on Skype and on Viber, but we haven't really held this little baby. And grandma and grandpa are just dying to do this, but we can't go for a weekend to South Africa. But here a few months ago, our son was kind of debating whether or not he would actually go any longer with Transworld Radio. He had a 3-year commitment, and then they usually come home for a short furlough, and then they recommit again. But he wasn't sure he was going to stay. He thought, well, he would come back to the U.S. and just get a regular job, and maybe he would support missions. And to Grandma and Grandpa, well, this sounded like a very good idea. But all along the way, I mean, selfishly, it was like, yes, 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 yes. But ultimately, I knew that he and Elise had to do the will of God. And though inwardly I wanted them to move back, I never prayed, God, move them back. I prayed, Lord, help them to do your will. Help them to know your will. And a month or so ago, before the baby was born, God told him, stay in South Africa. Oh, why did I pray that prayer? No, not really. Ultimately, as a parent and a grandparent, I want them to be here. But as a follower of Jesus Christ, I want them to serve the Lord above all else. And if that means serving in South Africa, that's where it is. I hope that for all of you, wherever God leads you, that you'll answer that call. And if your family goes, man, you're crazy, you go, yes, I'm a fool for Jesus. You may have to do that someday. Some of your families will be very supportive if you go in the missions. And I'm not saying you all have to. Like I said, some of you are going to stay here in good old Nebraska the rest of your life. Some of you may even stay in Wayne. That'd be cool. He said, now there's a limit to staying in Nebraska, right? We want to go to Omaha and Lincoln, the big city. What if he calls you to stay in Wayne? Would you do that? Yeah, go to Africa, but not stay in Wayne. 4 years in Wayne is enough. What is God calling? There's something He has for you, and I don't know what it is, and it may lead you down some wild, crazy path. Will you leave the comfort of your home state and you go to Texas or Colorado or Nebraska? Well, you're in Nebraska. You might be called to Mississippi or Alabama and learn to talk a new language. Or called to Africa and learn to talk a new language. The important thing is, it's the will of God. And those who know Jesus Christ as their Savior sometimes are called to take risks that don't make sense. What Paul did didn't make one lick of sense. But he was empowered by the Holy Spirit, he was called by God, and he was faithful. As we wrap up, this message of the kingdom of God that Paul preached, if you trace the concept of the kingdom of God, we don't have the time to cover this whole thing this morning, but in the Old Testament, the kingdom of God was primarily a focus on the nation of Israel being restored to great power with the Messiah, the descendant of David, sitting on the throne in Jerusalem, and all the world would come and worship Yahweh, worship God, and worship Messiah in Jerusalem. This was the promise of the kingdom. This is what the Jews were looking for. They were looking for a military leader to come in and destroy all the evil people and reestablish this great kingdom. That's what, when at the beginning of Acts, when they said, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel now? That's what they were looking for. But something happened. Something changed. And if you follow the Gospels, you'll find that something changed. Although God knew this all in advance, Jesus came presenting the kingdom of God. The message of John the Baptist, the message of Jesus, and the message of the disciples was originally, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And to every Jew, they knew exactly what that meant. The kingdom is coming. But there's something happened along the way. And if you follow the Gospels, in Matthew chapter 12, the leaders haven't liked Jesus to this point. But they finally had enough of him. And they said, this man Jesus cast out demons by the power of Satan himself. And at that point, their rejection of Messiah was complete. The end result of that rejection was the crucifixion. They rejected their Messiah. Yeah, yes, some people accepted him, but the nation as a whole, the religious leaders, rejected their Messiah. And something changed from that point on in the Gospels. Jesus begins to prepare his disciples for a new form of the kingdom, which is the church. This is God's kingdom now. Now, this doesn't mean there won't be a future kingdom from Israel. There's different beliefs about that. But the kingdom now, the kingdom Paul is preaching, is this new form of the kingdom, which is his church. This is what God has established now. This is how God witnesses to the world. This is how he builds his kingdom on the earth, is through his church. We are the kingdom of God. We are the followers of the King. The church is the kingdom of God now. And this is what Paul was preaching. The kingdom of God And the Lord, everything about the Lord Jesus Christ, the leader, the one who's in charge, is the Lord Jesus. He's the one. So as we end this book, I want to challenge you a little bit to think. Now, as we have studied the book of Acts, most of you have been with us through this study. And we've gone through this whole thing, and we've seen the Holy Spirit come. We've seen miraculous things done. We've seen over and over and over again, numerous people come to faith in Christ. We've seen the spreading of the gospel. We've seen miracles being done. We see people stepping out in great faith, whether or not their lives are on the line or not, for the cause of the kingdom and for the gospel message. As you look at the church back then, and now try to go forward 2,000 years and look at the church today. It's a hard comparison to make, I know. But look at Acts and what we've studied. Look at the church today. Does the church look the same? Just think about that for a moment. Now, I realize it's hard to compare exactly because we've crossed 2,000 years of history. We've crossed an ocean. We're in a totally different culture today than what they had. But in essence, is the church of Jesus Christ what it started out to be? And that's the one I want you to think about. And I think of the church as a whole. What is the church in America? Are we representing of that first church? And again, I realize that there things have developed, things have happened. There's been even a development of some of the teaching in the New Testament. But the New Testament has been written. The church is here. What does the church look like? Are we accurate representatives of the church that Jesus Christ established? He told his disciples in Matthew 16, he told Peter, "You're Peter, you're rock. On this rock, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." I'm not saying we aren't, I'm just asking the question. How well do we represent the church that Jesus Christ actually established? As we wrap up the book of Acts, I have a few things I want to point out. I think we've learned from the book of Acts that represent what the church of Jesus Christ must be doing. If we're a true church of Jesus Christ, not just church in name or in organization, but the true church that follows Jesus Christ, that exalts Him as Savior, what do we see the church doing? So what I would like to do is give you a few things to wrap up the book of Acts. I think these are lessons we've learned all the way through and lessons that must be present in the church of Jesus Christ today. The first one is this. The church must be empowered by a dependence upon the Holy Spirit. That's how the church began. And that's what we see all throughout the book of Acts, that the Holy Spirit was moving in the lives of people. There was a dependence. There was a trust. There were times when they didn't even know what to say. But the Holy Spirit empowered them to speak the truth of the Word of God. It can't be just me up here preparing a message and speaking. It must be empowered by the Holy Spirit, or it's just a message. There must be a dependence. Everything must go forth by a trust and empowerment of the Holy Spirit. It's not just us working and doing good deeds, although we've been called to do that. There must be an empowerment of the Holy Spirit. We must be trusting in the Holy Spirit to fill us, to empower us, to know that when we do something in the name of Christ, it's not just me doing it, but it's the Holy Spirit empowering it and causing something to happen that goes beyond just human ability. We can present the gospel, but if it's not empowered by the Holy Spirit, it's just a message. The Holy Spirit must convict the person. The Holy Spirit is the one who leads a person to Christ. We're the one who delivers the message, but ultimately it's the Holy Spirit that saves one, that redeems, that fills one with the Holy Spirit, that gives the new birth. Jesus redeems, the Holy Spirit gives the new birth. The true church is empowered by a move of the Holy Spirit. The Church of Jesus Christ must proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ to the world. If that's not evident, you hadn't been paying attention. I'll have to start over. As I said before, if we don't preach it, who will? Who's going to do the? Who's going to present the gospel if we don't do it? The church must present the gospel. There was an article in the New York Times called "The Stories We Tell Ourselves." Philosopher Todd May notes that we're often telling stories about ourselves, mainly to make ourselves look good. He writes, "We tell stories that make us seem adventurous, or funny, or strong. We tell stories that make our lives seem interesting. And we tell these stories not only to others, but we tell them to ourselves." May says that most of us live in echo chambers. Okay, get this picture. An echo chamber that reflect the righteousness of our lives back to us. And in our echo chambers, we justify why we and our group are superior to all the others. In short, we tell ourselves a very narrow and shallow story. What he's saying is, really, if you look beneath, is at the heart of every human being, there's a need to be wanted. There's a need to be important. There's a need to be significant. And we do this sometimes. We try to find our own significance in telling stories, whether they're true or partially true or whatever. We want to present ourselves as being someone who is significant in this world, because we all feel a sense of insignificance. Some of the most confident people in the world are actually suffering from a feeling of insignificance. That's why they present themselves as confident. It helps them feel better. What I'm getting at here is that we have all these stories, all this information, and it's fine to tell funny stories. I like funny stories. Tell funny stories or tell stories about something you did. That's okay. But ultimately, as followers of Christ, our primary story is the story of Christ. That's the message we've been called to proclaim. Who He is, what He did, and what He's going to do. And there's a lot of information in those three statements. Understanding that He is God. The Son of God, yes, but He's also God, who came to the earth and chose to take on human flesh, not because He had to, but because He loved us. And that Jesus lived the perfect life, demonstrating for us what God was like in the flesh, but ultimately came and fulfilled His purpose of dying on the cross for our sins to become our Savior. That's this Jesus that we worship. And now He has risen again. He has conquered death. And we celebrate the resurrection this time of the year. But I wrote an article in the paper this week. Put it in the paper. It said, why do we wait till Easter to celebrate the resurrection? Why not celebrate it every Sunday? Every day of the year. That's the victory we have, is His resurrection. And it's because He is alive that we can proclaim the gospel with confidence. Because it's not our gospel. And we are not the ones who save. We're just the messengers. This is what we're called to do. Okay, I need to proceed on here. The church must preach and teach the Word of God clearly without reservation. We don't always agree exactly what this book says, but the church must proclaim the Word of God. That's why we often study through a book. Yes, I'll do sermon series, but we often study through a book. Try to cover as much of it as we can to present the whole truth of the Word of God. The church must be unified in purpose and belief. Oh boy, have we fallen on that one? This is probably the biggest problem we have in the church in Jesus Christ, is unity. Not only as a whole, but sometimes as individual churches. This unity of purpose. Why are we here? What's the purpose? So we can have a nice building to come and sit in? Well, there's nothing wrong with having a nice building, but that's not our primary purpose. So we can fellowship with our friends? Well, that's wonderful. I'm glad you come to fellowship with your friends, but it's not our primary purpose. You know, is it so you have a community? Is it because you like to teach? What is it? Our primary purpose is the advancement of the kingdom by the proclamation of the gospel. And then the belief, there are basic beliefs that we need to adhere to. Truths. Yes, there are some differences in many churches, but there are some basic beliefs. And by the way, we're going to study those next fall. If you're interested in that, we're going to have a special class that we'll be digging into some of the basic beliefs that the Bible teaches that are crucial to the message of Christianity and the message of the Bible. We'll be digging into some of those. The church movement learned this lesson too. The church must be open to all people, regardless of their ethnic, cultural, religious, or economic background. Now, we don't accept every culture or every religion, but their background. We accept all people. Remember, we learned that there is no place in the Church of Jesus Christ for prejudice and racism. There's just no place for it. And it doesn't matter whether that's prejudice according to ethnic background or prejudice according to economic background or whatever. Or even, political background? Ooh, now maybe that's okay. Maybe we can, no. We have to be open so that all can come and hear the gospel and all can grow in their faith. The church must be led by godly individuals who are dependent upon the Lord. We see this advancement of leadership. As Paul got near the end of his life, his last three books were books on leadership. 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus, about the leaders of the church and how they were to carry on the ministry. It doesn't mean that everybody else can't be a part, and that's why we try to have ministry, that everybody can be a part. The whole church needs to be involved. It's not just about the leaders. It's not just about me. It's about all of you. But the church has always had people who led it along. And that's why you need to pray for the leaders of this church. You need to pray for me because I am, too, a fallible human being just like you. Finally, the church must pray. Yeah, right. Church must pray. Yep, we do that. Do you? Some of you do. You know, there has never been a significant move of the Church of Jesus Christ that wasn't undergirded by prayer. Prayer and the preaching of the gospel and the preaching of the word. The church doesn't advance without those three. But prayer that undergirds everything. This was the foundation. Jesus, God in the flesh, found a need to go be by himself and pray. The disciples prayed. It was a foundational principle of the early church. And without prayer, the church isn't going to go anywhere. We'll just be a nice little Christian club. But the call of the church is much greater than that. It must be undergirded by prayer. There was a gentleman, some of you know, if you like jazz, maybe you know this name, Horace Parlin. Anybody know that name? Got one person knows that. He was a jazz pianist. He was born in America. He was abandoned by his original parents. He was adopted. At seven years old, he contracted polio and lost a lot of control in his right side. But he eventually learned to play the piano. And he became an actually proficient piano player, jazz player. And you can look him up on the internet. Remember we talked about the internet last week? And YouTube, you can listen to some of his music. It's there. But it's an amazing that he actually lost the control of these two fingers completely. Yet he could play the piano just beautifully. In an interview with him, he talked about this inability that he had, that he learned to develop a facility with my right hand that I worked out myself, he says. He said, I was trying to voice chords using as few notes as possible. Of necessity, he made a greater use of his left hand than most jazz pianists do when improving the melody lines. As he put it in the Jazz Times in 2010, I had to find my own groove. Here was a person who became a very skilled pianist, jazz pianist, but he was partially paralyzed in his right hand. Why am I telling you this story? Regardless of who you are, regardless of what your background is, regardless of what limitations you think you have, God has a call on your life. And you have the power of the Holy Spirit within you. And through the gospel, through the word, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, you can overcome anything for the cause of Christ. God has called us all together in the body. And sometimes a part of the body hurts. Another part picks that part up. And the body of Christ must work together. And you are a part of the body. And our goal is not just an individual representation of Jesus Christ. It's the representation of the whole body. And so as we look through these various things that the church must do, I challenge you to evaluate those in your own life. I challenge us as the church to evaluate that in our church. Are we representing Christ as He is designed here in this community for the glory of God? Let's pray. Thank you, Father, for your goodness and your mercy and your grace. Thank you for your church. Thank you for allowing us to come and be a part of that church. Thank you for redeeming us and saving us, those who know you as Savior. Thank you for this message of the gospel that goes forth and that people can believe and receive Christ and be saved and born again through the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, that we don't serve a dead Savior, we serve a risen Savior who's alive, and your work is going on in this world and in this community, even without us. But we want to be a part of it. We want to be a part of what you're doing. Help us to be the church as you designed it. Help us to be faithful to this presentation of the gospel. Help us to be dependent upon you and the Holy Spirit. To proclaim your word. To be open to those who need to hear the gospel. To build up and strengthen people so that they can become mature in Christ and even become leaders and to yet fall on our knees and pray in dependence upon you. Use us, Lord. Take us and use us for your glory. May the gospel go forth in this community, on the campus of Wayne State College, in this county, and continue to spread beyond. And may you start with us. Use us, Lord. We commit ourselves to you, and we pray this in Christ's name. For his glory. Amen.